Hello.
Hey, part two. Let's demolish everything. Demolition derby. What do you want to abolish next? What do you want to abolish next? That guitar back there, huh?
I want to abolish your dick jokes.
Well, we have to have at least one infant on any podcast at any given point in the human ecosphere.
You can take that role. I'll leave that to you.
You can be the high-minded sort.
I don't know if I want to. I'm not going to claim anything. I'm just going to be here and try to be myself. How about that?
As long as you call yourself Jesse in third person.
Okay. Well, Jesse has some thoughts this week. I want to pick up where we left off last week. What do you think? When we ended the conversation last week, we mentioned a couple sites, the 8toabolition.com and the movement for Black Lives. And I wanted to just maybe we could walk through some of the main points in there.
And they're also listed in the show notes for last week's episode as well, at the very bottom.
Yeah. But maybe before that, what about this week? What happened this week?
What do I make of this week? Well, I'm just...
What do you make? So I guess specifically I was like, what do you make of, there's two that are touted as major Supreme Court rulings this week.
I think it's an example of the social power of the streets having an effect on decorum of the Supreme Court. So, you know, this is not the ruling I expected from the Supreme Court as it currently exists, but the Supreme Court and the people that constitute it have a great deal of anxiety about their legitimacy. And we saw that in the case with Obamacare, where in the last minute, I think it was John Roberts, I mean, it wasn't Sam Alito, but had changed his position on Obamacare because of a concern about what the Supreme Court would look like if they ruled against Obamacare, basically plunging everybody into darkness, even as savage as that, you know, welfare state patchwork system was. We're talking about throwing, you know, millions of people off of healthcare. And so I think it's an example, once again, of street folk politics having a place in terms of creating upward pressure on the legitimacy factor of the Supreme Court.
Yeah, I think that's a good take. The two rulings in particular were the upholding that, or the ruling, the first one in the week was the ruling in favor of LGBTQ rights, according to the 1964 Civil Rights Act. People can't be fired because apparently there are a number of states still in the U.S. where people can be fired if they're lesbian, gay, transgender. And then the second one was upholding of DACA, or was ruling against the Trump executive order to try to rescind the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrival program. So
which is interesting because wasn't that done through executive order with Obama too at the very end or last year and a half of his term? I think that was also an executive order, and so it was an executive order against an executive order.
Yeah.
Law. Well, what is it worth?
abolish executives. How about that?
Exactly.
That's what we need to get to. I wanted to also just mention to you that how much I appreciate and hope that we can keep, well, one, that we can establish a rhythm doing this, having these conversations, even though, and recording them and putting them up, you know, we've tried from time to time to get into the groove and over the couple of years that we were away from publishing podcasts and never found our groove again in circumstances, but hopefully we can keep doing this. One, I was like, for me, this is really, you always say like, what's good for my brain? Like, it's sort of a bit of therapy or something, but there's a therapeutic aspect to this. And there is, like, I feel so, you know, we talked about our mental health before in these conversations. And
since we're on the polar opposite ends of that,
Right. And how my depression is linked to my politics, if you will, right? That it is about understanding, like being radical is not, and having a clear understanding or attempting to have a clear understanding, I should say, of how fucked up and backwards the design of the world is, can be extremely disconcerting, to say the least.
When it's also when you have a clear idea of what the utopian horizon should involve as, you know, things in the suitcase for the future, certainly it's makes you feel despondent, because we all deal with the sense of dejection at not having agency in our lives in all kinds of ways. And there's different levers that we can push on occasionally. And then there's these moments where like, oh, look at all the levers move because we all got out on the streets. So I feel genuinely more optimistic that there's been a decision in the last 2 weeks that the new world sucks and the old world shouldn't accompany it. We should use COVID as a blast off launcher to something else. Yeah. And that the old world is disgusting and gross and we don't want it back.
Yeah. And in this disgusting vortex of violence that is this capitalist, realist, necro-capitalist nightmare that we live in, having the opportunity to talk to someone else who can recognize the facts of the matter, that this is totally fucking avoidable, that this is by design, and that we can and need to design something else. I appreciate that opportunity, right? So like having these conversations is good for me. And I just wanted to mention, because I shared with you a couple of things, I just want to reiterate, put a pin in a couple of things I shared with you over the internet earlier this week, helped me feel less alone in this, and just in the sort of clear-eyed understandings of what's happening now and how this might connect to larger, longer, bigger, broader struggle for liberation globally. One was the video interview with Henry Giroux. He's a American-born academic who teaches in Canada, but he writes a lot in Truth Out. Anyways.
Yeah, and he often shows up on This Is Hell podcast. I know him from there.
So he just, in terms of putting this current moment in context, and or I think really insightful sort of observations there. So I want to remind, and we can leave in the notes to a link to that video, that interview. Also, appearance on a webinar series by Adrienne Marie Brown. Adrienne Marie Brown was a writer, and she was the editor of Octavia's Brood, is with a collaborator launching like next week, I think, a podcast that is that read-along of the Parable series.
Chapter by chapter.
Yeah, chapter by chapter. So I picked up, so I haven't read those books because, you know, I don't read fiction much. So she had a really good, helpful things to, sets of observations and takes and things to say about this moment that I was crying while watching it. So highly recommend that. And then third,
Watching that, I'm going to watch it.
Good. The third was that the two-part podcast interview in the Intercepts podcast with Ruthie Wilson Gilmore. Talking about this whole moment and connecting it to the larger abolitionist struggle.
And her book, The Golden Gulag, which we mentioned in the prior episode.
Yeah. So those three things, I just want to put a pin in. And again, share that those were important for me this week. You might find them helpful.
Watching my son put Legos together was inspiring.
Well,
he wants to be a YouTube star. So
is that the way these days?
Yeah.
What do you call his generation?
YouTube generation. I don't know. They've been saying that for 25 years, so I don't know. I guess my son's on the dividing line between, Generation Z or Zoomer, which they hate that term. And then they hate being called Zoomer because it sounds like Boomer. And then Generation Alpha.
Yeah.
This is also a sign of the paucity of imagination, is that we can't even nickname people like sports people or generations. We just come up with a stupid ass, let's just use the A through Z alphabet because we have no actual idea what we're talking about. And then like consumer packages, every 15 years we have a new generation. Like it's like preset.
Pepsi
this is what Sharon Mulburn talks about in Generation Left, is that generations are actually political in nature, less having to do with demographics. And rarely is there massive demographic shifts that you have to name a generation, which is why baby boomers are called that, because it's both the beginning of the baby boom and also the end of the baby boomers, the beginning of birth control. So it makes sense on a demographic level that you'd have that, label, but everything else afterwards. I mean, if you look at the you know, Generation X, it's all been, you know, housed under the austerity of neoliberalism. So it's, you know, desiccated lives and, you know, low wage work. So it's just a continual crunching down on what existed prior to the baby boom era that they deeply profited from. So there is an idea that we could think of this as a political generation in a way that's different, especially from 2011 onward.
What do you mean this?
Well, the George Floyd is part of this.
Folks born after 2011.
Well, these larger and larger outgrowths of a political agitation in ways that we haven't seen that come so close together. So, you know, I think this is where the key is what Sanders, you know, of the mistakes and failures of that 2020 campaign is. I think he did a better job. I'll say this for what is a generally not a very good campaign is that he did a very good job of bringing on the three parts of the movements that came out of Obama's last years, which was, you know, Occupy, the undocumented DACA student and kid revolt, and then also Black Lives Matter. All three of those movements kind of were in and around 2011 to 2015. And so you see, in some sense, that Bernie was able to kind of bring those issues into his platform, but was unable to do the kinds of things to engage in class warfare that he needed to do to win the Democratic Party. And so now we're going back to the days of Fire, the days of Occupy, the days of Black Lives Matter, and we're seeing once again a return to the streets, and we're seeing more efficacy, more effectiveness than Black Lives Matter or Occupy just in a couple of weeks. And we could chart this, that we're seeing the pressure points change, and the crisis of legitimacy is a mirror image of what we wanted them to see, these ruling elite that don't care about everyday people.
And this is moving at a pace that, like we mentioned this last week, right, about this needs to happen.
Yep.
It needs to continue to happen. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about where things are in terms of what you're hearing from what's happening in the street, what's happening in terms of responses to pressure from the street?
Well, I'm seeing where are we on this wave? Well, I'm seeing in Riverside the pressure coming up because some of these police offices in the United States had set up almost in a really deceptive manner these pay raises that were coming out right after these uprisings. So, like in Riverside County, Chad Bianco, this piece of shit, this Trumper, he wanted a 30% increase in the county sheriff department wages because they do such a good job, you know. And so the 9:30 in the morning on the day after the 5,000 plus uprising and protest in Riverside, the very next morning there was going to be a vote to increase wages by 30%. Well, guess what? We caught wind of that very quickly and organized the people that came to the protests to fill up the phones for the Riverside County to prevent this wage increase from happening.
So people are on the street saying defund the police.
Yes.
And clearly thousands of people out on the street in Riverside saying defund the police, abolish the police, be held accountable.
Yeah, our framework is a little bit different. Yeah, our framework is a little bit different because we have to, the phrasing that's being used by All of Us or None, or really great organization that has a local chapter here in Riverside, is equitable investment, which if you're radical might sound absurd, but given right. the leverage that exists in the current county makeup of the board, you have to use that framework to push. And we can't just say abolish the police because we're a pretty purple county. We're not red state or blue state. And so if an organization largely made up of African Americans and Chicanos and Latinos are saying, let's just use equitable investment, I'll have to trust them on that because they've been working on these issues longer than I have. And so you kind of stand back and listen on that. And so the framework we're using is more like equitable investment. So if you're going to use this for punishment, you better use this for prevention. And that's, if we get that, that's still a win because Riverside City and the county budget for the county, which includes Palm Springs and Indio and all that it's like 40% of the budget, you know, 50%. It's a huge, it's astronomical. Now, if you're a rich city like San Francisco, it can be a very small percentage because you don't have to buffer and police inequity to the same degree that you do in more working class environs. So I think that's what we're seeing is that this is translating into pressure on the electoral system, right. which is good, which is great. It's better than Occupy.
So you're saying that activists in Riverside County, the approach that they're taking is to pursue equity in investment in social programs.
Yes.
With the police. So it's not an ask for a decrease. The demand isn't an ask for a decrease in funding or equipping the police at all. Is that right?
Yeah. So it's essentially saying, like, okay, what's the leverage we have? We have the shared utopian horizon that you or I or everyone else does that cares about the end of the police and the beginning of utopia and the end of austerity politics. But what's the leverage we currently have, given the level of entrenchment in the county board with the police union money, the correctional facility money, the land developers and the ruling class? We are a purple area. We are not at the site of the bleeding edge of the revolution, which is in Minneapolis. We're not a San Francisco, for instance, where you already don't spend that much on police anyways, compared to Oakland or other areas like Richmond. And so the All of Us or None and others that are organizing us, including the, I think, resurrected, i.e. Black Lives Matter chapter, which was kind of not really active or defunct until this George Floyd tragedy. And so, and Breonna Taylor tragedy and Ahmaud Arbery's tragedy. So we see that communities are going to respond differently in different areas. But I think you, and I will share it in the show notes, there's different areas are doing different things. And there's a website that actually locates the kinds of pressure points that are being turned into transformation.
The mapping where abolitionist work is happening, progress. There was a useful framework from Critical Resistance that I shared with you before too, which was sort of how to evaluate whether or not a position or a measure is abolitionist. You know, is it a reformist reform or is it an abolitionist step? Mm-hmm. And so I guess I'm curious if, because I don't know anything about what the group in Riverside County is pursuing, but maybe if we just look at this framework, right? Because it's, is it a reformist reform or an abolitionist step? So looking at it, does it, one, reduce funding to the police? The two, challenge the notion that police increase safety? Three, does it reduce the tools or tactics or technology that police have at their disposal? And finally, does it reduce the scale of policing? So if it's, the answer is no to any of those, then, which most of the reformist reform things are all towards giving more, not challenging the budget, legitimacy of the police, not challenging the budget, and often just giving more funding to the police. So from what you know, the activities there in Riverside County where you're at, are they abolitionist steps or is it more reformist demands?
If it's just reforms, it's like the Obama shit. It's just like, give them more cameras, give them more training. Even Bernie Sanders, boring ass, is saying, you know, pay them more. They should be more professionalized workers. So that's just the neoliberal reforms. But what All of Us or None is doing is looking at the ways in which we can start to put up a fence around their endless growth and start defunding or moving that funding. And I think the framing they're using is saying, look, we're not cutting the budget. We're just moving the budget to other types of policy outcomes and goals. So it's not like we're trying to hurt people. We're just moving the money to places that we benefit from.
Is it to reduce funding going to police though? I mean, because
it's all about the reduced funding to police. Absolutely. Because they're not saying, hey, let's take money from something that we like and move it to something else that we like. It's like, no, we want to stop the police. And right now it's more defensive, which is Chad Bianco wants to increase the wages. It's you know, increasing the budget at a time of pandemics and plagues. And so that is the first part of that push. And then the push after that is the kind of things that you're seeing in LA County, where you're at least chipping away, however small, at the budget and reducing the amount of money that's going to payouts. And Alex Vitale talks about this in his most recent interviews, as well as in his book, End of Policing, that you can downscale the police by simply freezing out hiring. So slowly transition the police out of hiring is a really smart, cunning way, because isn't that what they did with tenure track and teachers in universities? They slowly froze hiring and just replaced them with adjuncts. So if the neoliberals did that with their divestment of education, we could certainly take the same strategy, because look how effective it's been at the community colleges, where 60 to 75% of the fucking teachers are part-time, living in the back of their car trunks. So that's an actually legitimate reform. If you can actually reduce the funding of the police, you can reduce also the amount of money they're putting into elections and also reduce their voice in terms of funding and build up other kinds of funding mechanisms that will also have their own voice as they grow in power. So
if indeed the push is one that is going to reduce funding, even if it's using language that isn't making that an overt thing, that's using language other than demanding a defunding of the police or whatever, if the measure and the move is to reduce the funding, then that looks like it's coming from an abolitionist, that it is an abolitionist step.
Mm. I think the benefit of seeing all of these different things happening on a local level is you're going to see different effects on different parts of the country that the activists can model from. Now, that doesn't mean that the police state and the supporters of the police state won't model from what's effective on their end for fighting back on this forward movement. But certainly if we're smart about it, we can look at Minneapolis versus LA County. Now, LA City is supposed to cut the budget for the police by $150 million. But that seems like more like they're just not increasing it like they increase it every year. And whereas Minneapolis, the city council has decided to disband the police. At least this hasn't actually happened. It's just a verbal promise to disband the police. So there's going to be different levels. And I think what we can take from this as activists and people that want a utopian horizon is that in each city of each area of the country, we can look at what's effective strategies and tactics.
I'm just reminded of this again, that last year I was in Chicago in the beginning of July and I attended the socialism conference, right? And I told you about that experience and how many of the I was less than impressed with many of the sessions, but the one session that I did attend that had the most energy and was the most useful and engaging was a session about, what was it? What was the title of the session? Oh, it was Abolish the Police, Liberal versus Revolutionary Perspectives by the activist Brian Bean. And one of the things that he said in there and is in the paper that he's published subsequently about this, I think is a good sort of framing for considering the terrain of this abolitionist movement is, he says, rather than attempting to transform a pig into a pony, reforms we fight for have to aim at trying to limit cops, to put a muzzle and a leash on their violence. Generally speaking, socialists ought to support any reform that can limit the number of cops on the street, that gets them out of schools and off campuses, that reduces their budget, their access to weaponry. Indeed, we should back any measure that tries to place restrictions on their belligerent behavior.
Mm-hmm. As we know, the violence workers. So, I think Ruthie has been saying too, like the first thing that ought to be happening is, Alex Vitale says this too, is going after the police at schools. And this is going to be interesting at UC system-wide. We have police on campus, and we've already had these incredibly, bloated ceremonies of apology from chancellors across the UC system, but no mention is made that we are now going to get rid of our cops on our campus, right? So the levels of behavior on the police on campus is noteworthy because when I've driven to and from work, I've often seen UC cops pulling over folks of color all the time. So it's not like this isn't a thing. And so the question is, we need to make this full-scale assault on the police state in terms of its treatment of children in the K-12 system, but also these universities that are the temples of liberalism and the shrines of liberalism and what we could call, as Nancy Fraser calls it, progressive neoliberalism, where the semiotics of progressivism is not traced to actual praxis or actual equity, but is a performative gesture, much like Elizabeth Warren writ large. And so what's going to have to happen is, will activists put pressure on the UC system to take the police out? Now, there's some of that already going on at UC Davis and UC San Francisco, but I haven't seen anything for UC Riverside. So that might have a lot to do with the fact that this is happening when nobody's at the campus anymore.
I think removing policing from institutions of education is a
should be the lowest hanging fruit. I mean, right?
Yeah, should be low again, low hanging fruit. That, like, why the fuck are there cops in schools?
And why is it the low hanging fruit? Because education is part of the golden square. It's like, yeah, it's supposed to be sacred. It's a sacred human right, education. So it is the low hanging fruit because it's something that should be wholly decommodified. And Ruthie talks about that in the Intercept podcast, that, you know, financial aid is a system of a deputy state. These are deputized people that decide who gets financial aid and who doesn't. Do you have a felony? Did you have a felony? Well, you can't get financial aid, right? So it's an extension of the carceral state. And by at least pulling the carceral state out of the golden square of education, we can ask more critical questions through that decommodified space, right? And so it makes sense that you'd want to go after the police in the educational environments because this is supposed to be sacred land.
I want to move along to, like I mentioned at the outset, to back to where we left off last week, mm-hmm. to abolition and the movement for Black lives. And I'll start with this, the aid to abolition. Mm-hmm. Again, aid to abolition being a, there was this aid can't wait sort of campaign that happened a few weeks back. It's sort of like mm-hmm. a rebuff of that. So like, this is what they've already done. Aid can't wait is just a bunch more reformist reforms. We need abolitionist steps. We need to
Interesting too, because Black Lives Matter was co-opted very quickly to like All Lives Matter or Blue Lives Matter. And here, this is the reverse, where a reformist garbage website comes up to protect and fence off any fundamental transformational change. And then they co-opt their language back, which is interesting, right? I mean, Susan Fields had problems with the phrase Black Lives Matter. And she's the one that's her sister and her are authors of Racecraft and extremely intelligent on notions of race and racial formation. And the language that you use can be co-opted very quickly. And they did that precisely to these kinds of people that want the status quo. So it is really brilliant that they did that.
Yeah. Well, enough is fucking enough.
Right? Yeah.
This is enough is enough of this mm-hmm. bullshit. We mm-hmm. can't wait. How long are we going to wait? We can't wait. Yeah, we can't wait, but we need to abolish it. So first thing is defunding. Mm-hmm. I had just thinking myself about this, putting it in context with how I had been thinking about abolition and had been part of my whole sort of outlook on how we move towards a more just world. I had thought of sort of and it had been shared elsewhere too. So it wasn't just me thinking this of defund, disarm, dismantle. Mm-hmm. Sort of basic sort of parameters of how do we go about what are the things to push on towards abolition and disarming police, defunding them, and then working to dismantle them altogether.
And we're seeing that too, like with immediate city council votes to end the use of tear gas in Seattle, mm-hmm. for instance. Whether or not the police seem to follow those is another question, but rubber bullets. And these are things that have been added to the arsenal of the police state over the war on terror. So when these investment schemes to funnel more money into the military state goes into the domestic sphere. And so, yeah, definitely. The question is, we hold them accountable that the police don't use these things and then are treated as such as basically the villains they are when they use these weapons against democracy. And it's important to remember, like, you know, defund, disarm, you know, demilitarize is a good way of looking at the abolition movement.
Yeah, well, let's say defund, disarm, dismantle. Mm-hmm. The 8 points in the sort of push are, one, defund the police, to demilitarize communities, so disarming the police, taking weaponry out of their hands, 3, removing police from schools, so we were just talking about that, 4, freeing people from prisons and jails. Mm-hmm. So this is, again, the abolition, this project is not just about abolishing the police, the mm-hmm. thugs that patrol the streets and keep working and poor people in line, but the whole carceral apparatus, the whole prison.
My only question about this is the steps. It's basically the 8 to abolition, the 8 steps. I don't think they're really make sense if you're thinking it clearly as chronological ordering. Because when you're talking about investing in community self-governance, providing safe housing for everyone, invest in care, not cops, those would go alongside of the removal of police funding, because you're going to take those existing funds and move them to those other eight steps. So I think it's important to think of them not as necessarily chronological things, because if you're going to defund the police, then that's when you put it to housing. Yeah. That's when you put it to these other things. I'll put the meme in the show notes, but there's a funny meme of someone pouring coffee that has like five holes in it. And it says defund the police, and all the coffee goes out to these smaller containers for like housing and healthcare and education, basically the golden square, wage growth, and all those kinds of things. And so you move that money to the places you want it to go, right? So as you defund, you also reinvest. As you defund, you also create more public housing, community land trusts, those sorts of things. So when I said to my friend, activist friend Maribel, that, you know, if we defund the police, we can there very quickly say, why don't you fund the community land trust in our city, which we're starting up. So just move that money over. And the benefit of that, not just saying defund, is what often happens when you try to say, I'm decreasing the military. Mitt Romney said that you can't decrease military in this 2012 campaign because we'll lose jobs and it'll hurt the economy. You nip that in the bud by saying, well, no, we're moving the money to places that do create jobs, right? And Ruthie talks in that Intercept podcast about how supposedly this prison Delano was going to create 1,800 jobs. It really created 72 jobs. And the mayor says, well, the problem is our situation is so bad economically that I can't say no to even 72 jobs. And even if I know this, and that's important to think about the Inland Empire, because geographies of violence and abandonment are also ways of acknowledging what things are not visible, which is that areas that don't have resources and capital have to be, you know, more and more vulnerable to capital in terms of pollution and warehousing. So definitely that's the important part of why I say it shouldn't be chronological, is because the way in which we defend the defunding is by saying we're taking those existing funds and just moving them to better places.
Yeah, this is not a chronological step-by-step sort of strategy. Mm-hmm. This is eight things that we need to, eight fronts. This is just sort of putting in that framework to sort of, again, like you said, to throw back against this eight can't
wait. I think this is the qualities of co-opting language, because eight to abolition sounds like it's a chronological step.
Yeah, no. These are eight things.
Truly, these are strategies and effects that we want to encounter and see in our communities.
Yeah, eight things that are movements towards, that are steps towards abolition. So, you know, also repealing laws that criminalize survival, invest in community self-governance, provide safe, accessible housing for everyone. There we go, part of the Golden Square, and fully invest in care, not cops. So there's a lot of language too I'm seeing around about defund, refund, invest, divest is one of the policy platform points of the movement for Black Lives. So the whole notion of reprioritizing spending, right? So of defunding the police so that we can fund other social good programs, so that we can actually keep, we can create the conditions of community wherein we don't need, so we can create safe communities. The police just make everybody less safe.
Yes,
so,
absolutely. He did it again?
Yeah. Constant sabotage. Constant sabotage.
Dude, I'm... Now he turns the light off.
Turns the light off.
Jesus Christ. This is what happens when your dad's an anarchist. I just don't hit him. I don't yell at him. He calls me a dick face. He just, you know, whatever.
Gonna become a cop.
He's starting to actually question that, I think. So he was interested in cops when he was little. I was horrified. He actually had a cop outfit. We actually still have it. It was like a motorcycle on him. It's horrible. One second. Yeah. Well, the interesting thing is, like, when Lennon learned about George Floyd, he's like, oh, I guess all that stuff about cops I thought was wrong. So it tells you that, you know, when you take down the monuments, you take down these signs and symbols of normalcy. You know, certainly if you watch, Christopher Nolan's crypto-fascist Dark Knight Rises, you're like, oh my God, this is a total masturbation jerk off to the police and NYPD. It's like, did they pay for this film? So, you know, there's certainly something to be said about when we talk about aid to abolition, that there is the aspect of how we're creating the conditioning for this institution of violence to continue, is because there's the statues and all those things.
All right, the digressionist. Let's get back on.
Oh yeah,
let's go back. Because I wanted to thread. Okay, all of this effort, this the abolitionist conversation starting to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing that there's a way to understand whether or not reforms that are being pushed for in any location mm-hmm. are actually in sort of abolitionist direction, or are they just reformist reforms and just masquerading? Or are they outright just reinforcing the tyranny of the state? But this whole context of the economy
mm-hmm.
and there's a circumstance under which we are experiencing this moment, and seeing how that the conditions of the COVID pandemic and all of the responses to that have given rise to, or have been part of, this spark of revolution, and the massive levels of unemployment, along with minor measures of relief that were offered, at least to some, through the CARES Act,
mm-hmm.
right? The one-time relief payment, and then the additional $600 a week added to unemployment insurance benefits, giving conditions under which people are not, or some folks who may have found themselves out in the street engaging in this conversation, were not in their 40 hours a week job, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
you're not working 40 hours a week, you have time to engage in real work.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there's that sort of condition that I think is...
The community work that's so needed, right? UBI would create the pathway to be more involved in community affairs.
Right, but don't you think, is that a fair sort of observation? Is that accurate kind of...
Oh, absolutely.
Or an accurate take on what may be one of the contributing conditions for the moment?
Oh, absolutely. Well, we have the right environment in which to enact UBI, because it's becoming quite clear that you can't reopen anything and that nothing has fundamentally changed in terms of testing, inadequate testing, PPE masks. Basically, the entire country is turned into Flint, Michigan, and nothing's changed. And so the ability to institute universal basic income or universal basic dividend, which will happen later, would allow for the further movement in terms of defunding and reparations and economic justice and those sorts of things. So we can start to generate those things in a much more rapid fire notion when people are not threatened by the right to exist, right? Like that they actually have the means financially, at least, to start thinking about their community more critically and to not feel so exhausted. Because once again, when we're asking people to do activism and organizing, we can't expect them to be full-time organizers, but we do need to figure out a way for them to pitch in that 2 to 5 hours a week to make for a decent humanity. And so definitely, if we can get, and this is why Nancy Pelosi and Mitch McConnell don't want to really have UBIs, because they know that it would fundamentally alter the power dimensions of the United States, where people could actually ask for more. And winning, the good thing with winning, when you win, you want to win more, especially when it comes to good shit for society.
So universal basic income would definitely be something that would help in this moment.
Oh, and I think Black Lives Matter should, I think this is perhaps, we have our own blinders being who we are, but it's interesting that aid to abolition and the movement for Black Lives Matter isn't explicitly talking about universal basic income as part of reparations, right? As decommodifying human life. And you could easily imagine this movement that we have right now that's wide and growing to encompass UBI as a principle for further power. And we have at the point a real good side of leverage and possibility where in July, the Bernie bucks, as I call them, will run out and $600 extra pay will disappear forever from July 31st on, and there will be nothing to replace it. And Mitch McConnell and Nancy Pelosi don't give a fucking shit about this. So let's just get UBI right now and use that as a leverage point, given that COVID's creating that framework, that terrain.
I'm trying to suss out of you to get to the question of how you're going to pay for it.
Yeah, how are you going to pay for it? Right.
So I wanted to get to this thing, because we'll continue the conversation about this and connecting all of these dots. But so at the moment, right, there's a focus
mm-hmm.
on the gravest, kind of sort of the tip of the iceberg, the mm-hmm. gravest and most overt function of violence inflicted on the population by the state.
The bleeding edge of the violence of the state is the way that folks of color are treated by the police.
Right. And Black Lives Matter movement, the movement for Black Lives, Me Too, Extinction Rebellion, on all of these fronts of the fighting against the patriarchy and the violence as part of the program of the patriarchy, the violence against all working folks that is racialized capitalism across the globe and the damage to our ecosystems. There's all of these are part of the same sort of fight, right? The same sort of movement
away from a death cult, death-based institution and a death cult. I mean, when you're talking about climate collapse, you're talking about patriarchy and Me Too movement, we're talking about different systems of violence that rotate in and out of our lives, some seen, some unseen. And, you know, we're organizing against the death cult that really wants to take us over the edge to extinction.
Well, where I wanted to get to, where we can sort of leave off and then pick up next week, was again to a front of myth busting, which is about money. So there's never been a real shortage of good ideas for how to design the world better, right? It's just we've been under the tyranny of ruling elite for all of our history. Right. And so we live in the ruling elite's world. And whenever we want to fight for something good for the, so how the fuck are we going to pay for it? Right. Because we all live under this myth of these constructed mythologies about the economy. And so
this myth doesn't exist for capital and finance. I mean, we've spent $5.5 trillion already, but it's going to the banks, it's going to large corporations, and they're perfectly happy. They're not saying to cut the stimulus. It's just whenever it goes to good stuff that the myth suddenly reenacts itself with this absurd level of violence and caricature. There, it is a myth. I mean, if you're pumping money that goes to extending efficiencies in your economy to actual what we call the real economy, you can do it almost endlessly and not have inflation. And this is the thing is, yeah, there's not a great theory on modern monetary finance and modern monetary theory, but this is a myth and it's being used as part of the controlling system because it only goes in one direction. This myth only works when it's for everyday people.
Right. There's not enough money for things.
Yeah, they've not once said this once. The Chamber of Commerce, the Fed, nobody, even the banks, Chase, Fargo, they're not saying, oh my God, you can't do this. You're going to cause inflation.
Right.
They only say that when it goes to us.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So this myth is just, it pops out like a Halloween costume on October when you want it. But then it goes back in whenever it's, jerks off capital.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned modern monetary theory, and so that's a whole
other thing. But that's that's part of the Stephanie Kelton has a book called The Deficit Myth that just came out that will put you into deficit to buy the ebook version. But the large problem is that the economy right now has already been privatized towards private ends. And it's socialized in that manner. So it goes to the top when it wants it. And there's no consequence. There's no discussion of austerity for them, but it's austerity for everybody else. And so I think I'm curious to you, has this kind of UBI in Canada, now is this $2,000 in Canada going to everyone in Canada that's a citizen or permanent resident or just the unemployed?
No, this is like sort of extension of unemployment benefits.
Oh, so it's not nearly as breathtaking as what I was hoping.
No,
because Americans get confused. We all think this is they're doing UBI there, but that's doing.
We have a series of disasters on the horizon, from the clock running out on the CARES Act additions to unemployment insurance in the U.S. So the $600 a week ending in the end of July, like you mentioned, unless there's a HEROES Act passed or who knows what, or care, extension of the CARES Act, unless there's some movement by Congress to extend those protections, people are going to start hurting.
We're about 2 months away from, there's a article that says that we're about 2 months away from really the plane hitting the mountain.
Yeah. I just want to lay out what the plane hitting the mountain looks like in rough, really rough terms really quick as we wrap this up, because because I think we want to pick up here next week, maybe. Mm-hmm. So running out of the unemployment insurance and the CARES Act stuff, there's the moratoriums that have existed mm-hmm. on a patchwork basis across the, remember there's moratoriums on collect, like people are going to start getting evicted, like broadly without, unless
disproportionately African-Americans and folks of color, they're going to be seeing this really quickly.
The larger institutions like public universities that had the resources to sort of put the brakes to and to absorb the effects of the pandemic and the lockdown are moving into new fiscal year. And so there's going to be a huge series of layoffs and cutbacks and and a sort of austerity politics happening all over again. That's really going to start to hit come midsummer here. And then all of this leading up to this presidential election in the U.S., which is a total fucking catastrophe.
Two zombies walking around that are partially clothed. Maybe Joseph Biden will make a complete sentence and Trump will try to finish that same sentence and it all makes sense together. But yeah, two zombies for president. Pick your zombie, the one that smiles more. But yeah, all those things come crashing down. I mean, the moratorium on foreclosures and rent, the Bernie bucks will disappear if it's Nancy Pelosi not feeling the heat from Chad Batar's campaign against her for her position in San Francisco district. So for Congress. So, and you know, there's places to go, like Booker going against Mitch McConnell in Kentucky. So there's areas where we could actually put light and heat on the elected officials. And once again, Trump is a creature of the polling. So he will maybe consider things he wouldn't otherwise consider if his polling continues to go downward because he's so transactional and so obsessed with his celebrity. But yeah, we, by August, we're going to be having all these things that we've been trying to put off come to a head.
And, you know, hopefully we can keep having conversations through all of this.
Hopefully the internet works. I don't know. The earth doesn't get so hot that the internet won't function anymore. So
I know in the middle of the summer, this is going to be horrible.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The heat's starting.
Okay.
Well, yeah, I think that fundamentally by August, we're going to see all the things that people were trying to organize for. Remember, in May 1st, there was attempts at a rent strike. There was attempts at wage strikes in the United States, but it didn't really take off, whereas George Floyd later on did do the kind of work to bring about these massive uprisings, these orchestrated. I mean, I don't know how many more May Days I can go through with expecting May Day to actually become May Day, but it was George Floyd who was really our May Day. You know, we needed a person's story to inspire us, and the suffering that was so disgusting and tragic that it forced people to stop accepting the status quo and stop being passive creatures to an environment that wants to kill them.
And we got to stop accepting the excuse that there's just no way we can pay for anything better. Like that's
garbage
and utter bullshit. It's complete and utter bullshit.
And this is what we know is we know we could have had Medicare for all. Like right now, $5.5 trillion, you only need $1 trillion to start up Medicare and it already pay for itself anyway. So we already spent 5 Medicare for all bills, basically.
Money is a fabrication and everything that is tied to money is a complete and utter fucking...
Let's make the right kind of acid trip, not the wrong one. So if money's a hallucination, let's have a good hallucination with it because it does have real effects downwardly on folks of color, on the undocumented. It has effects on service industry of folks pumping Diet Coke into bottles at manufacturing facilities or at Carl's Jr. You know, so we have a reason to believe that we can create the right type of hallucination.
It's not even wild. Everybody has... clean water, clean air, healthy, abundant food, a home, shelter, safe community, access to education throughout their lives, and high quality healthcare. Money is not an obstacle to this.
So are you describing white suburbs or are you describing Denmark? But yeah, all the things that we think we are necessary for dignified life, the Golden Square.
Yeah. There's no reason. There's no reason that universal provision of the Golden Square can't be the basis for our social arrangement and the full and entire function of any administrative bureaucracy that we create. Mm-hmm. The purpose of governments, if we are to have a state at all, the purpose of the state, if they're going to be legitimate to any degree, mm-hmm. must be measured against whether or not that apparatus helps to provide in a mm-hmm. universal way these four things, these four mm-hmm. fundamental Golden needs square. For yeah,
a dignified food. Life. If from that dignified light, we can create the rainbow light that we want for the future, right? The human flourishing, the utopian sphere. And that's really important.
Anybody who's going to distract away from that is going to like make up some excuse or we don't have the things to do that, whether it's money or fucking bullshit.
Bad faith actors.
Mm-hmm. Bad faith. I'm thinking a lot about this professional managerial class and sort of
PMC
theory, you know, theory
that's
of change.
The Enreich article to that famous phrase, PMC.
Yeah, professional managerial class. Because I'm more and more thinking that it is with the professional managerial class that our fate rests.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Right. So we this is, you know, we put pressure, you know, from the streets, pressure from the ground, pressure from this kind of discussion, you know, happening over and over and over again. This is, you know, this kind of pressure, right? Mm-hmm. Where we're like, we call fucking bullshit, mm-hmm. but the folks in this pyramid scheme.
Conflicting identity. A PMC person is of conflicted identity, wanting yeah. to be the ruling class, but also feeling the might yep. and the anger of a downward trajectory on wages and income. And you see this at the colleges with adjuncts versus mm-hmm. people making six figures as a vice provost. The PMC class is divided in itself.
The PMC class is the whole industry of folks who wrote well-crafted messages to put into your inbox. A message from our CEO, we stand with Black Lives. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Fuck you. Fuck off. Give your company to the workers.
Yes. Yes, you're not going to create the right letter with the right font to actually create the dignified world we need. I love the fact that you phrased it that way and that you have the right tone, but your tone is not a good one.
Yeah, sorry about my tone.
PMC will remind you of your tone. Use the right tone.
They do over and over again. I have
this word, it will change everything.
I know by all measure. As an educated white male person, I should be part of that class. I've had every opportunity to walk in that door, and I just have not, and I'm a complete failure. Sorry.
Let's get that rainbow light. So
rainbow light.
Thanks for joining us today, and we'll continue this conversation on abolishing the police.
Abolishing America.
It's just trees and grass and some frogs and stuff at the end of the day.
All right.
All right. Take care. Later.